primarily that we should look at green building criteria. I think we got some very interesting points that added to the user benefit, which is probably the durability of the building, which is probably looking at from a people's perspective, the craftsperson or the master builder, and from a people's perspective and a user perspective, the guarantee of a life of the building. Okay. Can it last 60, 50, 40, 50, 80 years, etc. We also looked at peer certification processes. I like that because it in fact puts the pressure on each other to compete and therefore get a better plan. And you're not dependent on a third party who you don't know. It's actually a peer group that's actually reviewing you. Makes huge sense. We can look at state level initiatives, state level certification, and have competitions interstate, so to speak. Each state can in fact allow the certifying agency as well as the certified to get incentives or motivation or prizes or recognition to make them move faster, better, higher. The reasons for certification were doubtful, and I think we realized that when builders want to certify their buildings as green buildings, it's really to get into the fast lane on the MOEF permissions, etc., etc. It's really grease money without the money part of it, which is not exactly the reason why they should be doing what they're doing. Money savings and profits, we realized, were not going or percolating down to the user, occupier, the buyer, were staying in the pockets of the developer, the promoter, or the investor. And we had the story of different parameters for different building types and typologies, so it was getting extremely difficult to set that up. We could look at post-occupation analysis and a green rating system to certify star green products. I think we spent a lot of time in the last half an hour talking about that. I'm going to take you down quickly with what we've been talking about for the last couple of hours. Effectively, we're saying that we all understood that we would go the education route. And I'm saying it's not purest education, it's also awareness and exposure. And we're saying it's packaged content across all stakeholders. What do we mean by stakeholders? We have put this slide up and I'm explaining it to you again. Level 1 is at city level. Level 2 is at earth level. It's a sort of universal branding scenario. It's a sort of universal, everybody's involved relationship. Level 2 is pretty much the city, which is appropriate to that city. Level 3 is pretty much the neighborhood in which that building or that enterprise or that institute or that campus would be. And the fourth and the smallest is the buyer and or family, or the user or occupant or whichever way you want to look at it. The awareness program, obviously, the big picture statement is to protect the environment. We'll come to that, how we do it, etc. Thanks for your slides. The overview of the messaging methodology, I think the medium or the language that we use or the quantum of information will need to be very carefully chosen, appropriately chosen, depending on who we're talking to. Also, the breadth and depth of information, and I'm going to spend a minute on this. What we do probably when we talk about a base level education or exposure program, we probably go very wide to explain all the impacts or all the issues that we have. As we go higher up the value chain, we probably go a little deeper than that width, maybe narrow down our efforts, and maybe go deeper in certain areas, and we'll see that as we go through in the next couple of slides. So level one, when we're talking about it, it's talking about across the masses. What do we talk to the masses about? And when we say masses, we're talking about Indians in general, the aam janta. It could be villages, it could be 30% of the people who stay in urban spaces, it's going up to 50% in the few next years. We're talking about villages, we're talking about semi-urban, we're talking about townies, etc., etc. Having said that, we talk about the earth, and this is content. We talk about the limited resources that we have in the earth, on the earth, as we speak. Depleting stocks of coal, depleting stocks of fossil fuels, the investments in renewable energies, etc., etc. We can talk about climate change. We can therefore talk about impacts on plants, animals, and human beings. We can can talk about the integrated ecosystems that we have. We can talk about energy in its holistic terms, why we need energy for what we do, how energy inverts and converts. The price of aspiration and the cost of ignorance, I think these are very critical issues that we need to be able to address. The price of aspiration because, you know, everybody wants to run to town or everybody wants to run into an urban environment because they think that's a better way to live. And the cost of ignorance is because I don't know anything about that, it's going to cost the earth or its citizens a future. The key message also that we've come up with is sort of an actionable agenda. And the actionable agenda will be how you can make that difference, how you can go forward in addressing these issues. Second level, when we come across city level, we're talking about consumption, because now we're talking to an urbanist, we're talking to a person who's experiencing urban life. The qualities of that person, or the education, or the resilience, or the experiences of that person are very different from a sort of simplistic worldview in the villages maybe. Consumption, his ecological footprint, energy security, the quality of life, regional carrying capacity, social equity, disaster awareness. We must remember that we're talking at city level. What I talk to Bombay about is completely different from what I talk to Calcutta about is completely different from what I talk to Delhi about. So effectively, what are the impacts of those? We talk about the identity of the city in the sense of context. Delhi being a capital city has a completely different context to Bombay. That is a commercial city which has a completely different context, which is Bangalore, which is an IT city, etc. So obviously, language will be skewed. Topics will be different, the depth at which we'll go in these cases will be completely different, and we can talk appropriate figures of transportation probably, or appropriate issues of disaster management, etc., etc., as per city. The urban heat island effect, how Kafkarate's buildings in concrete, 20-30 buildings clustered together, takes Kafkarate's temperature up by almost 4 or 5 degrees from the other areas, maybe even Fountain of Kolaba or further north in Bombay. And what's the action of the agenda over here? We start talking slowly but surely about responsible growth. We're not saying, and no political party will allow us to say, stop growth. We're saying growth has to be responsible. And this is pretty much after this kind of processing that we can talk about issues of responsible growth to the city slickers. The third impact is much closer to home in the sense of we're talking at a precinct level. So if there is a building, and here again we're looking at one residential building for example, impacting a sort of community. We're talking about infrastructure, social movement, managing waste, community participation, measurable impact, demonstrable ideal neighborhoods, scalable models, scalable models, urban ecologies, in the sense that I can't say when I go to the neighborhood and I say there's a 100-story building coming up here and there's probably going to be 2,000 people staying here, that neighborhood guy is going to be thrilled saying it's an opportunity for business for me, for example. The neighborhood, the other buildings in the neighborhood will say, oh my god, wherever their car is going to be, they'll be taking all my water, they'll be looking at stuff like that. So we have to sort of build our cut our coat according to the cloth we have and address the different people and stakeholders where we need to address them. The most important thing is if we can allow them to experience green, if they can experience green, then they can maybe be responsible for the green. We change them into advocates for us, we change into some evangelism. We change them into evangelists and champions so that we can subsist and coexist. If we took an activist component or an activist sort of role saying, you know, hey, you know this guy, he's got such a big building and we're going to be spat out or we're going to cause a riot over there and we'll be slipping out, but those guys have to live with that building or this new residence for the rest of their lives. So I think it's a very balancing act It's a very sensitive balancing act that we need to do. And the fourth is the buyer and the house. Here we're going straight to the point. I mean, hitting him between the eyes and saying, listen, you were probably charged extra. Now you need to know what you bought. And make him aware of her, aware of the family, aware of what they bought and what they can expect from that little premium that they've paid, or what they can expect from what they've been promised. And therefore we are saying you can talk to them about energy performance indexes, environmental performance indexes, whichever way you want to start with EPI. Claims of the builder versus the benefits to the user. And here's a classic direct correlationship. If the builder has said that I've got an energy rating and I've set up VRV machines for you, or I've set up LED lights for you, let him quantify that. Let us measure that I'm getting what I've paid for, I'm getting what I was at least promised. We talk about energy, waste, water, whatever it is. We talk about cost management, maintenance, benchmarking, baseline analysis. And the last point that we are saying is that if one can add value beyond all this, so the builder has sort of been, I'm taking a shot at this, I'm saying the builder at arm's length has done a green building. Get it certified, get my money in. After that building's pre-certification or whatever it is, he's forgotten about it, he's moved on. But I'm saying that you've got a product, and if you can add more value to that product, why not? And that's what I mean by the adding value. Maybe a small section of us who are in the education responsibility field are telling that guy or this whole user-friendly society, the user society, that you can expect this from your lighting or this from your air conditioning or this from your garden, etc., etc., which may not have even occurred to the builder or developer when he sold it. Like you were saying, I mean, green building and you put plants in the lobby. Or we give you a green wall on the back side, something like that. So what's the actionable agenda over here? I think this is where the buck stops. You paid that premium, now you be accountable for that. You can be converted into an evangelist and start telling everybody the advantages of your green building experience, of living in an experience, and living in and experiencing a green building, etc., etc., by virtue of either exchanging notes over the clubs one evening, saying to my electricity bill comes to this, or something like that. Okay, that's where we are.
Add value also by having somebody make a business out of taking care of these people.
Yeah, sure.
That builder will forget, that is for sure. If there is somebody who
there are already promoted, there are
already look after all these things that they work.
There are already a huge bunch of what they call facilities management guys who are wearing ties and suits and doing the housekeeping and the cleaning and the catering and the washing and whatever XY that you want done in these large societies. Yeah. There are people.
Mainly to maintain the green.
There are people. Like that. That's, you know, when you are paying an outgoing of 40,000 or 50,000 rupees a month, okay, that's the sort of service that's thrown, which makes huge sense. I think it's a very valid point. So there are facility managers, I think we should put that in.
These terminologies you are using, the benchmarking, baseline analysis, EPI, is it really appropriate to talk to at this level? Because the terminology is very difficult at this level.
See, I was giving an example of my own office. When the air conditioning manufacturer came and sold me a VRV system, he said, you will be dropping your bills by 70%. Okay. I said, I don't know what my bills are. This is the first time I'm getting into this project. You are expecting me to put up 30 lakhs, 35 lakhs of rupees, buy something, and you are guaranteeing me a 70% reduction. 70% reduction. Now, I'm saying the benchmark is the first day I start my air conditioning. At least I have that as my baseline figure. It's not easy at all. It's bullshit. Okay. But try telling me that. Okay. I mean, end of the day, he's trying to entice me to spend that money. And dangling every challenge you said in front of me to say, hey, listen, this is a much better technology. So at so least day one
with his words.
No, at least day one. At least day one you can measure, and then you benchmark against that. Okay. No, at least you can measure at day one.
At least not your baseline.
But it's not your baseline.
Yeah.
I'm saying your benchmarking can happen on that. Okay. How else would you do
it? Especially for energy consumption, at least we go for a 3-year variation.
But
seasonal variation.
But sir, that's what I'm saying. In principle, I have to start somewhere. I can take my first recording across the whole year.
Yes.
Okay. My facility manager can do it. I mean, my own example, after I was expecting to pay a bill of $70,000, my first bill is 1,25,000. Okay. He says, let the system settle. My next bill is 1,25,000. He says, no, this is the first month that the ESP has actually checked your meter twice. Normally they check it every alternate month and average. The third month he says, this is May, so it's very hot outside. So again, it's not very hot. I'm saying, hello, if the third month of May is 1,25,000 and the first 2 months or the first 3 months of January, February, March will be less. Okay, I can understand there's a difference between 1,25,000 and 1,45,000. That's where it goes. So I'm saying this is the whole market relationship, and someone somewhere has to step in and say hello.
I think we are trying to this segment is the smallest segment. We're saying so in the case of Pune, 7,500, the smallest one. So we are saying that this segment who is going for green buildings, let them be aware of this. Okay, I agree that EPI is a very complex word and all that, but we want it to be familiarized among these people so that they can demand. Okay, they may not have the answers initially, but at least the fact that the consumers are not now going to demand, what is your EPI? That guy is giving me a better EPI than yours. Whatever it is. So that is
or
the kind
I can
of.
Tell in a simpler term, for a 1,000 square feet, house. For a household,
very difficult. Very difficult.
No, but
one guy has 75 LEDs in his room. Another guy has 50 CFLs.
Then how will you compare? Unless you have a
I'm saying you do the comparison on your own.
This EPI is on the basis of square meter per year.
So flat to flat. Not building to building probably. Flat to flat.
No, that's what I'm saying.
We can do. End of the day, we are trying to figure out how best you can compare and compare to your advantage.
My suggestion would be, using some simpler terminologies.
Yes.
Not to convince.
No. We are talking to the converted here. We are using jargon, much more jargon than all of us, I'm expecting, can understand. When we go down, if you remember my first slide, I'm saying the language.
Okay, then it
the education level.
Can you add that line
here? The language will be simplified.
Then it will make sense.
Look at this. The breadth and depth of information will be imparted in varying modules to suit the addressing. Age, gender, locality, accessibility to education, technology. This is my first disclaimer.
One response to the questions. One response is that it's very comprehensive, very important. If two or three core people were to sit down and prepare a recommendation and a policy statement, it would be possible to do so with this structure. One suggestion related to education part, where you could think of any, is the historical continuum in order to explain why what is important and not important. So the historical continuum business is forgotten. People think only in the present. So when you're talking about climate change, this, that, and the other in the future, there needs to be a backward linkage as well. One suggestion. For the last slide, I'll just tell you a small anecdote, my own building. We built an additional house behind our own arms, which got an award. It was built by a good architect. And whenever he spoke about it, the only thing he said was, ethnic house banaya hai. That's it. And the last thing I would talk about it is to call it an ethnic house. I prepared 2 pages of stuff and gave it to Mr. Rao. And I said, this is all what you have to say. The moral of the story is that unless you interpret your building to the person concerned, without that interpretation, for instance, we went down or up.
Yeah.
Without your interpreter, it would have just been going up the thing and coming down and getting tired.
Yeah.
So interpretation is something which we need to add into this whole.
That's
claims of the builder is okay. Good interpretation by the builder.
Very sound.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Two suggestions. One,
very good.